begin the sermon. Let's go to Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3. We will not be moving to any other spot besides Colossians chapter 3. Colossians 3. And today's Father's Day is pretty well known. Just like with everybody, fathers want to improve and become better fathers to their children and husbands to their wives. Sometimes, maybe you're on the path that isn't going so well at this point, or some may, shall I say, be on the path that isn't going so well. Maybe things are not going great. Maybe in your relationship, your marriage isn't going as smooth as you hope. Maybe you're not married and you're not a father, but you want to find a way to improve yourself and to become a better person. Well, the Bible has an answer for that. We can become a new man, a new person. It takes a little something for this to occur, but today in Scripture, we will examine how to be a new man and what we must do to not go back to our old self. Colossians chapter 3, let's just take a look at the first verse. As we open the Bible, we open the mind of God. So let's see what he has for us in verse number 1. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. I tell you this morning, if you want to be a new person, you want to be the new man, again, that's men and women in here today, you want to be a new person, new man, you can if you are in Christ. But you must cut off the things that will hinder your walk with the Lord. And we're going to look at that when we look at the first 17 verses of this chapter this morning. Father, we come to you in prayer. We thank you for the day you've given to us. We thank you for the opportunity that we have to be able to be into your word. Father, I pray as I preach, help it to be clear. Help it to be easy to be understood. Help your spirit to move in the midst. Convict hearts where they need to be convicted. Save those who need to be saved. Strengthen those who need to be strengthened. Encourage those who need to be encouraged. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So, first of all, where do we set our affection? Before we get into the old man, the new man, and all this stuff, what's our point? What's our purpose? Why are we talking about the old man and the new man? Let's look at verse number 1. First of all, the first word of the verse, if. If is a great sentence. It is a great word in English in general. But if creates a lot of scenarios. There's a choice, first of all, to be made. If. And then the second word is if ye or you. And that's multiple people. Ye is plural for you, second person, whatever, all that grammatical stuff that goes on there. It's plural. So if you, and then it can relate to yourself too, if you are in Christ, if you're in Christ, what does it mean to be in Christ? Well, if you're in company with Christ, then you should set your affection on things above. Let's look at the verse. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. What things? Things that are heavenly, heaven-minded. But what if you're not in Christ? What if you're not risen with Christ? What if you're not born again? Well, let me explain that simply to you quickly. Salvation is the most important thing in this life that you'll ever make. Why is it that a man needs salvation? Well, first of all, we're sinners. Once you sin, you're a sinner. Once you steal, you're a thief. Once you murder, you're a murderer. Once you lie, you're known as a liar. Especially if you're a habitual liar. So once you sin, you're sin. You're a sinner. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned. That doesn't exclude a single soul in this room. Those viewing online. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We may think that we can do all the good in the world, but you know what? That good is not going to amount to 1 millisecond. When God says, why will I let you into heaven? And you say, well, I did this, I did that, I did this. God's going to say, that's not enough. That's not enough. What does God want? Well, secondly, there's a penalty for our sin. Romans 6:23, But the verse doesn't stop there. It says, the Bible says the wages of sin is death, but there's an option. There's an alternative. The gift of God. How many of us enjoy these? I'm sure every single one of us, raise your hand. If you don't enjoy a free gift, never, we're not going to talk about that. Okay? Everyone enjoys a gift, especially when it's free. I mean, if you think about it, a gift is pretty much free. You get a gift for your birthday or Father's Day or Mother's Day or any other Grandparents' Day, which is a day that a lot of people don't recognize, but it's in September. Valentine's Day, all these days, and there's an opportunity to give gifts. Or do you just go out, husbands, and you buy your wife a dozen of roses just one day, plop on the table, and just walk off, and she sees it, that's a little note there. It's like, oh, my husband's so great. Or whatever the case might be. We enjoy something that's free. We enjoy a free gift, and God gives us a free gift. And that's eternal life. The free gift. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And so he offers a free gift. John 3:16, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever, that's a key term. That doesn't mean only select few. That means whosoever, anybody, believes. That's another key term. Believes. You have to trust. What is faith? The substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. I'm pretty certain, unless if you, I mean, I haven't even looked inside these pews, but we sit down in these pews and we trust that these pews are going to hold us up. But we don't know what is in there that caused that to hold up. We just know we sit down and we have a collapse. So we have trust in something we don't see. We don't see the interior and all that, how it's constructed and made. Looking the other day, I was driving on Atlantic and heading west out to Military. They're creating that new bank over there across from Dunkin' Donuts. I'm seeing these plywood boards. I'm thinking to myself, are they trying to construct that with plywood boards? I mean, if I were to really figure out how to construct the inside of my house, I'd be like, wow, it's pretty impressive how they do that. And now it's supposed to, they use material that looks like strong stuff, but it's actually pretty inexpensive material to do affordable housing. So we're trusting that by faith that that's just going to stand there. And so whosoever believeth, you believe in who? In him, should not perish, that means die spiritually, but have everlasting life. Because Jesus is talking to Nicodemus saying that you must be born again. What is that concept? You're born physically, obviously you're here, but you have to be born again spiritually. Until you've done that, you can in no wise enter the kingdom of God. So what do? You have to repent and place your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. Acts 2:38, Peter says, and repent, and let me be baptized, be placed into Jesus Christ for the remission of sin. You change your mind, go away from what you were doing, realize that you need to change your life, you believe, you trust Him, and He forgives you of your sin. Romans 10:9-10, that thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thy heart that God raised Him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is man's salvation. You need to have that time where you call out to the Lord and you ask Him to save you. And if you do that, then you are in Christ. So, let's come back to Colossians chapter 1 here. Coming down to the end of verse 1. So he said, for those who are risen in Christ, you seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. So, we should have a heavenly mindset, not an earthly mindset. Verse 2, set your affection on things above, not on things in the earth. Let me give you these verses here. 1 John 2:15-16, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. For if any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. Your affection should be on things that are heavenly-minded, not earthly minded. And that backs it up in verse number 3. For ye are dead to your old life, your old self, because you are renewed. And we'll get to that in verse 10, you have been transformed into the image of Christ. So for you're dead and your life is hid, your life is secure with Christ and God. We are dead to the world spiritually because we are alive in Him. Romans 6:2 says, God forbid, how shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Once you are saved, you do not need to go back to what you were doing. And if you are, did you believe? Did you trust Him? Matthew 6:20, lay up yourself treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. Verse 4 here, when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with Him in glory. Christ is our life. He's coming back. We don't know when He's coming, but He is coming back. And guess what? When He comes back, if you're in Christ, look at the glorious thought there. You're going to be with Him. You will also appear with Him in glory. If you're a Christian, you should follow Christ. If you're not, you can have that opportunity today before you leave on this Father's Day to be a new man. Now, what must we do to avoid falling back into the pleasures of the world? Before we set up the rest of the message here, Galatians talks about this battle between the flesh and the spirit. Spirit wars against the flesh wars against the spirit, and that's what we're about to enter into here when we get to verse number 5. So what should we do as a Christian? Well, we should put off the old nature. We should put off the old man. Verse number 5 to verse number 9. Mortify. Mortify there, cutting off, to subdue them. Mortify, therefore, your members which are upon the earth. And now it gives us a nice laundry list of ideas that we should go away from. First one, fornication. Fornication, sexual acts with another person before marriage, pornography. Many men fall into this trap. Maybe there's one here this morning that's into that trap. But it falls upon many people, especially men. Fornication is not a thing we ought to do. Second is uncleanness. This is the idea of impurity. Impure motives, being lustful. Number 3, inordinate affection. Inordinate affection means a passion or feeling which the mind suffers, or vile passions. The 4th one here is evil concupiscence, or concupiscence, whichever way you want to pronounce it, is a forbidden lust or desire, craving for what is forbidden, something that is not yours, similar to covetousness, but in a lustful way. Number 5 here is covetousness. Covetousness is a greediness or a greedy desire to have more, something that's not yours. And it continues. And why does he say cut off these things? Well, here's the result, verse 6 and 7. For which things say, the things in verse 5, the wrath of God cometh upon the children of disobedience. The Bible mentions in Hebrews chapter 12 that there is a chastening of the Lord. If you're following these things and you're into these things, don't expect it. You're not going to get away with it. The Lord will come. The Lord will chasten. Would you want to have the wrath of God on you? I don't see any hand popping up. I'm pretty certain we don't want to do that. But it says here, if we do this, these things say the wrath of God which cometh on the children of disobedience. And the sentence continues on in verse 7. In the which ye also walked sometime when ye lived in it. Before we were saved, before we were in Christ, we were doing these things. Maybe you haven't done any of these things here, but just in case you thought, man, I cleared the first 5, I'm good to go. Let's look at verse number 8. Let's see if we clear this list. But now, ye also put off all of these. Anger. Indignation. Violent passion. When was the last time you got angry? Next one is wrath. A fierce anger. A breathing, very hard anger to the point of boiling up in anger. I mean, you're just so enraged that it's like, bias and ill will with a desire to injure, or not ashamed to break the law. I mean, you're willing to do whatever you want to do just to make sure that your goal and your task is accomplished. Whether it's good or not, you're going to do it. That's malice. Blasphemy, a vilification against God, or an evil speaking, or a slander. Filthy communication, that's foul speaking. Low and obscene speech or vile conversation. Having a dirty mouth. Taking God's name in vain. Minimizing God. Swearing, cursing. That's not a Christian. That's not the way a Christian should be. It says filthy communication out of your mouth. Verse 9. Lie not one to another. To deceive, to utter an untruth. All these things should be put off. At the end of verse 9, so seeing you put off the old man with his deeds. Now, I understand we are in our body sin cursed. I understand that. But the Bible does tell us that there are things we need to put off. And these are the things we ought to put off. If your relationship isn't as strong with the Lord as it should be, maybe it's because one of these things are existent in your life. And you need to put it off. You need to subdue. You need to kill it off. To live the right Christian life, we need to avoid these behaviors, whereas not to turn people off to Christ. But finally, we're going to see what we should do to be a new man, to be the new man. And that's in verses 10 to 17. So who is the new man? Number 3, we should put on the new nature. So who is the new man? Verse 10 to 11. And have put on the new man, which is renewed. I like that word. I looked it up last night. It's a verb. And when I looked it up, it really kind of even changed the meaning for better in what Paul's trying to communicate here. This idea of renewed means to renovate or to grow up, or a new strength and vigor is given to one, to be changed into a new kind. So when he says here, put on the new man which is renewed in knowledge. What he's saying here simply is now you are a completely transformed person that now has the knowledge of who? God. After the image of him that created him. After the image of him that created him. Why is that? Well, when you were saved, a part of God, essentially you could say, lives within you, the Holy Spirit. And he renews you, he renovates you, he cleans up all the filthiness inside there when you get saved. And now you are a completely brand new person. And that's why it says renewed there. And it's an action, something that God does immediately once you get saved. So what else? Who else is a new man? Verse 11. Where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond or free, but Christ is all and in all. Who can be a new man? Anybody. Doesn't matter your background, your heritage, whatever it is, anybody can be a new man. So, we have been told to put off things. Now, we're going to put on. What do we put on? Verse number 12. Put on, therefore, as the elect of God. Now, that term can be misinterpreted quite a bit. Who is the elect? Those who are saved. Those who have asked Jesus Christ to be your Savior, you are now elect.
That's right.
You are now chosen to be into the family of God at the point that you get saved. And some take it a completely different way, but we're not going to get into that this morning. We're going to stay with the verse here and continue on. Put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved. Notice those two words there, too. As the elect of God. First of all, what are you in God's eyes now? You're holy. So you're pure in his eyes. And you're beloved. You're loved by him. You're loved by the God that's in heaven. And so because of that, because you are the elect of God, holy and beloved, now we see the things we God, number one, bowels of mercy, which is a tender mercy and pity for each other. You could say empathy or compassion there. Our kindness is the next word there. Moral excellence, integrity, and moral goodness. Next word there is humbleness of mind. Is being modest, being low of mind, not puffed up in pride. Being humble. Knowing where you're weak, accepting that, and knowing where to improve instead of saying, oh, I can do anything I want. I have not this problem with that. I'm going to tell you a personal thing. I'm very stubborn. I really am. Sometimes you don't see it, but I can be very stubborn at times. And at points, it's like, I can then boil into pride. And that's not what God wants us to do. Besides, it's one of the things that God needs anyway. A proud look. But we have to have a humble mind. Being able to accept correction. Being able to understand, hey, we fall short here. Here's how you can grow and improve. The next phrase here, after humbleness of mind, meekness. Having your power under control or being gentle. Long-suffering has an idea of forbearance or patience or endurance. Now, verse 13. Some of us may struggle with this definition here, but forbearing one another. What does that mean? Putting up with each other. Hold oneself up or sustain. I'm sure you can think of a person, if I were to mention a name, or who, you can probably name a person right and think, man, why do I put up with that person? You don't know what that person's like. Well, what's a part of the new man? Forbearing one another. Putting up with somebody. We may not, I guess, like them, or like their mannerisms, or like their habits, whatever the case might be, but it says forbearing, holding what's up, sustain each other. You already have an enemy of the devil. Why are we going to create enemies out of each other? Forbearing one another, and forgiving one another, forgiving those who have wronged you. Why is that? Verse 13, if any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. Notice how Paul is even more direct in the idea of forgiveness. Peter asked the question, how many times should I forgive? 70 times? And then Jesus says, no, 70 times 7. Now, that does not mean that you're going to forgive 490 times, and then 490 first time he wronged you, you don't do it. Now, Paul makes it more succinct. Every time someone does something wrong to you, don't hold a grudge. Don't hold a quarrel. Forgive them. Be quick to forgive. But you don't know what they did. They did this, this, and this, and this. And they probably did this, this, and this, and this. But what does the text say? If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do who? You, me, as Christ forgave me, I forgive them. No matter what they did. But what if they killed a family member? Well, you have the legal system for that. But at one point, you can't hold a grudge against that person. Let the legal system play out its process. But you should still forgive them. Now, should they expect punishment for what they did? Absolutely. Because no man has the right to take another person's life. But we should still forgive them. Jesus forgave all murderers, those who did other things. Verse 14. And above all these things, above all things listed in 12 and 13, put on charity. One of the marks of a good of a new man, of a Christian, is one who loves. And he loves sacrificially. The agape love is mentioned here. I love that you be able to do anything for anybody and anything. Christians love one another. That's 1 John 4 all throughout. We which is the bond of perfectness. Perfectness. It bonds everything together, brings everything together. Love heals all wounds, brings it all together. 15. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts. How? To the which you are called in one body, and be thankful. So two other things. Have God's peace rule in you, and be thankful. Verse 16. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly with all wisdom. Let God's word richly indwell you with all his wisdom. And notice this is teaching and admonishing. Now this is interesting. This is an interesting wording here. Let the word of God teach you, but also admonish, to reprove you. And notice what he says here. Let this thing teach and admonish you in what? Psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. The songs that you listen to should be doctrinally sound with their message about the Bible. Now, there is arguments today over the old-time hymns, over the new music, and whatnot. But what does the passage here say in verse 16? Teaching and admonishing one another. So teaching, helping, and then reproving one another in psalms and spiritual songs. What's the emphasis here? Let's look at the last part, verse 16. Singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. When we sing with graciousness in our hearts to the Lord. Not to sing just to get through a song. When we sing our hymns, we're not singing our hymns just to sing words. What we're doing is to teach us and to admonish us to see where we fall short, see where we can improve ourselves. The song we said, sang right before the message, complete in thee, each work supply. God can be completed in us. We can be complete in him because we're justified. All the songs that we sing can encourage us and also convict us at the same time. We ought to sing, not just to get through the song and get to the next part of the service, or to look spiritual. We sing because we want to lift our hearts in praise to the Lord and to prepare our hearts to hear from him. That's why we sing the hymns. That's why we sing the songs. And there are many people throughout the years and ages who pen hymns and give praise and honor to the Lord and teach Bible truths throughout the hymns and the songs that we sing. And then the last verse, and we're going to finish there. And whatsoever ye do in word or deed, everything we do, whatever we say, whatever good thing we do, whatever deed we do, as a new man, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus. Do it to honor Jesus. How so? Giving thanks to God and the Father by him. Don't do things, don't say things just to impress somebody else. Just to be like, hey, look at me. I did this, this, and this. Look at the action I did. Later on, this passage talks about men pleasers and all that and what they should not do in the workplace. But we should do all things glorify God. We do all things because Jesus is the worthy Lamb who took away the sins of the world. In conclusion, are you in Christ? If not, please consider that today. If you never asked Jesus Christ to be your Savior, what are you waiting for? Today is the perfect time to do it. It's a memorable day, as Father said. If you want to be a new man, new person, that's the first way to start. If you are in Christ, are you serving your flesh? Are you serving the old man, the old nature? If so, 1 John 1:9 tells us that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to you, and your flesh will want you to do things that are not honoring to God. I encourage you today, be heavenly-minded, seek things which are above, and be the new man today. Father, we come to your prayer. We thank you for the day you've given to us. We thank you for the opportunity that we have here this morning. Father, I don't know the hearts in here today. I can only see faces. I can only see the body language. But Father, if there's someone in here today who says, Pastor Chris, I do not know for sure that if I were to die today, that I'm going to heaven. But I want to know that. First, I would encourage you, don't be ashamed of that. Don't feel intimidated. Peter had to step out of faith when he walked on water to go to Jesus. But don't be ashamed. If you want to know how to get saved today, how you can know that heaven is your home, I would encourage you, as soon as we begin this invitation, that you come to the front. Don't bother what anybody else is thinking. Don't think, oh man, I'm going to be judged, because I'm not saying no. Quite the opposite is going to happen. We're going to be cheering you on and encouraging you, because now you're seeing that you need to be in Christ. Maybe there's someone in here today who is in Christ, but they're living in the old man, and they're not living for you as they are. Father, I pray that that person or persons would examine themselves. They would come and have a seat at their pew, or even more boldly, come to an old-fashioned altar and pray and ask you to help them to become the new man. And Father, for those who are saved and they are living in the new man, I pray that you would help that person. Help them to pray or seek prayer. Make a commitment up at the altar to continually live for you. That they would not, that they would be on guard, knowing that at any moment they could fall. Father, I pray that you would bless this time as we move into the invitation. For those who are not saved, I would encourage you, as soon as we start that first note, that you would come. The song is, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. I would encourage you to come. And when that music plays, there's someone who's saved but living in the old man, I encourage you to come. Pray at this old-fashioned altar. Pray with the pastor. The camera won't be on you. They will never notice it. But it's the time between you and the Lord. I encourage you to come. Make that commitment. And those who are, but you just need to pray for something else, maybe it's a matter you haven't discussed, come to an old-fashioned altar and pray to the Lord. Cry out to him. Father, I pray just bless and move this invitation time, we pray. In Jesus' name.